this is a world where everybody's got to do something. You know, somebody laid down this rule that everybody's got to do something. They got to be something. You know, a dentist, a glider pilot, a narc, a janitor, a preacher, all that. Sometimes I just get tired of thinking of all the things that I don't want to do, all the things that I don't want to be, places I don't want to go, like India, like getting my teeth cleaned, save the whale, all that. I don't understand that. It's late spring, early summer in 1998, and my heart and soul has been savagely knifed by a young female. A dark world enters the normally bright, shining life that I have known up until this point. For some reason, I'm embarrassed, ashamed, terrified to tell friends that I now stand atop the mountain of loneliness and despair, king of the sad, god of the ruined. I need a guide out of this torture, a real friend, a real parent, someone who stays overnight and continues to give and give. My search has just begun. Some people never go crazy. What truly horrible lives they must lead. Love is a dog from hell. That's what Charles Bukowski claims. A vicious attack, a monster with four legs and razor sharp teeth. Bitches. Rotten bitches, a man thinks, when dumped into the cesspool of pain. And I was thrown in head first and I did not know how to swim. I thought I lost it all. I refused to see most of my friends. I mean, even my good friend Joe Christiana and I wouldn't speak again for 12 long years. I knew I needed a change, a transformation. I immediately ran toward the Atlantic Ocean and didn't stop until I reached the shoreline. And this is where I would remain until I recovered from the horror of passion. This would be my hospital. Nothing familiar. Everything new. Maybe, just maybe, I will discover myself. Why did it have to be Eddie? He symbolizes everything that disgusts me. Obviousness, unoriginal, macho energy, ladies' man. The beach was in a pretty fucking good mood that summer because even though my thoughts and feelings were sour deep down, the beauty of life somehow found its way through every now and then. I read a ton, watched really great cinema, and drank. Oh, yes. The bottle is what made things work. The bottle would ultimately be my new guide, my new love for the next 10 years. The bottle and a copy of Betting on the Muse by Charles Bukowski would become co-captains of my new ship. So when they led me to Barbe Schroeder's 1987 film Barfly, starring Mickey Rourke as Henry Chinaski, Bukowski's alter ego, Barfly was it. It was the exact thing I was searching for. I would spend months, if not years, watching this soulful wreck. I mimicked Chinaski, walked like him, talked like him. I toured the bars, wrote poetry, didn't bathe, grew my hair long. I was a glorious mess, and I drunkenly loved it. I kid you not. I kid you not. I slept with more women, appearing as a dirty, disgusting, boozed-up sleazebag with a poetic heart than I do as a short-haired pussy with no guts. And guts is what it takes. Anybody could be a non-drunk. It takes a special talent to be a drunk. It takes endurance. Endurance is more important than truth. Barfly changed my life. Barfly carried me through some pretty fucking rough times, and watching it all over again was like visiting old friends. And for the first time in a long time, I felt alive. I felt like I could drink and fuck and write for days. watching Rourke saunter through the seedy streets of L.A. with dead-on observations and passion really belong in a very special place. So I say, drink that wine and do those shots and pound that beer, because we never know when we're going to get ours. And there is nothing wrong with living like a king, even if it's just for one damn night. That's Bukowski. That's Barfly. Directed by Barbe Schroeder and starring Mickey Rourke and Faye Dunaway. Written by Charles Bukowski. And as my hands drop the last desperate pen in some cheap room, they will find me there and never know my name, my meaning, nor the treasure of my escape. Gentlemen, Barfly, 1987. One of my personal favorite movies, man. I mean, this is something at a desperate time in my life when I just was at a crossroads of not knowing who.
So funny.
Yeah, go on, Joe.
So funny, Tom. I so funny watching this time. I was like, God, Tom really fashioned himself. Like, there's movements about the way Mickey Rourke portrays Bukowski in this film that I was like, God, Tom really took a lot from this movie.
I
didn't realize it until just watching it, actually, but a lot of things started to make sense to me watching it. I was like, holy shit, that's Tom.
It totally sank into me, and it always, I don't know, it became a part of me, and I don't know if I should feel guilty for that, or maybe even if that's unoriginal, you know? I don't know, but I needed something at.
Well, you drew. I could see that you drew confidence from it.
Yeah.
Like, you drew strength from his portrayal of himself.
Absolutely, and not just in the film, but listen. I mean, a friend of ours, Joe, during this personal crisis of mine, gave me books by Bukowski. He's like, you know what? He's like, read this stuff. It'll help. and it went.
Who is this, Taverny?
Yeah, it was Taverny.
He did something right.
But it did help. It did help. And after, like, reading, you know, I remember, I think it was Betting on the Muse, and it probably was Love from a Dog from Hell. I was mesmerized by this guy. Now, think about this, Joe, because, I mean, you love life, and you love reading, and you love this planet. You love the beauty that can be there in this planet. You know, the oceans, the forests, you know, so on, and the mountains, the clouds, the sun, so on and so forth. I spent, and you knew me, you know, I wasn't the kind of guy that would gravitate toward the beach. I found myself down at the beach just drinking by myself, meeting new people, reading Bukowski, watching Barfly, touring bars, and just really rediscovering how much I loved life. And
well, that's good.
Yeah,
that's
and
great,
Bukowski,
man.
Had everything to do with it. To do with it. You know, I mean, it took me until, you know, almost my mid-30s where I just was like, all right, I really got to clean my act up here. You know, this can't continue.
Well, there's a danger in romanticizing. Listen, man, I love Bukowski as much as the next guy, and I spent plenty of time in my early 20s reading the dude and love this movie and everything like that, like I do. And, yeah, I mean, I kind of got at him a little bit differently than you did. I found him after, you know, in my early 20s after reading the Beats and stuff. Sort of one thing led to the next, but at this point, you got to kind of realize that romanticizing self-destruction is a little bit, it's destructive. It's not.
Without a doubt. Yeah. And that's why, like, you know, I mean, at this point, it's like you could only have those moments, you know, every so often where you could just, like, drink your face off and forget the world and be.
Well, there's something to be said. There's something to be said about what he's doing, which is with alcohol that I think, look, I've done it with drugs myself and again, just like you. I mean, we're very similar in that, I think, in a lot of that, in that we just get obliterated to annihilate the self, you know what I mean? And you get to your dark, you get to a dark place where you're completely out of control. And it's like, there's an ecstasy in that, you know, and you can wallow in your darkness for years and years, or you know what I mean? Like, so I totally understand that. You draw strength from that. It's very liberating in a way, but at the same point, you could really, you can learn a lot of different stuff from it. So, but it's just amazing that I see how much you've taken from that portrayal in that, man. It's really fascinating. I was blown away by
it. I was just because I haven't watched this film in a long time, and I was too, Joe. Honestly, like, I'm watching it, and it just brought back so many memories. It's like watching it was like almost like watching my own personal documentary at times.
And well, Tom, like, it's so funny because I think even still, like, to this day, like, when I see it, like, there's moments where I know you so well. I know you probably too well, better than I probably would need to know anybody. I think we just know each other really well. Like, I see, like, moments when you're feeling really like good and you need a moment of confidence. It's like almost like you get possessed by the spirit of Mickey Rourke playing Bukowski. Like, I see it in the way you hold your head. It's fucking crazy. Like, you just look around and you nod at things, and the way he saunters around, it was very fucking weird watching this movie this time around.
And it was for me too, I'm telling you, man, because it just brought me back. It brought me back to that place, and I wonder. I sometimes wonder to myself because I was happy. I was so happy that like 10 years ago, just doing that and behaving like that. Here's the thing. It's like not giving a fuck, and now it's like I'm terrified. Like, you know, Joe, listen. I recently went to like just a different bar, you know. I'm like, I stopped going to the old bar, you know, that I always go to. And I'm like, I need to do something different. And 10 years ago,
Max, doing something different means going from one dive bar to the next dive bar.
Shut up. Well, in the sense that I needed to hang out somewhere else. I needed to change it up.
It was you needed a healthy change of scenery.
Shut up. But listen, I would walk into like places that I wouldn't even know the bartender, know the people in crazy towns, and I'd walk in and I would act like I own the fucking place. I walked into this other bar and I was like paranoid and terrified and quiet and afraid to play a song that I liked on the jukebox because I'd get ridiculed. Like, it was just god awful. And I thought to myself, I'm like, is this it? Am I done? Like, is this it for me? Is this it, that now I'm like just terrified of people? Whereas like I would just walk up to somebody 10 years ago if they annoyed me and slap their fucking hat off their head and keep walking. Yeah. You know? Yeah,
I hear you, man. Well, I could just tell you from my own experience that I was a lot like that when I was, you know, 20, 21 years old. I don't give a fuck if I looked like something the cat dragged in. You know, you remember what was going on back then. It didn't fucking matter. I was shaggy, flea bitten or whatever. Yeah. Like, I just think at some point you need to start to draw. You need to just it's good to find that the darkest, lowest spot that you can find, right, and obliterate any sense of care, and then build upon it and realize that you could draw strength from other areas. That's all I think, because I like what you, it's almost a mistake to romanticize and glorify self-destruction for too long. Right. At least that's what I feel. I've learned that. And you know what he does is a little bit, I know Max hasn't been in this conversation yet, but what he does is a little bit, I found an interesting quote here, right?
Okay.
So Ebert is, and it applies to what we're talking about here. Ebert is interviewing him, Bukowski, on the set of Barfly, actually. And Ebert's writing, a million guys start out to get drunk and become great. A million guys start out to get drunk and become great writers, and one makes it. Now a million more guys are probably getting drunk trying to figure out how Bukowski did it. He isn't a survivor. He's a statistical aberration. In one of his novels called Women, he describes the face of his hero, who is obviously based on himself. And he writes, the scars were there, the alcoholic nose, the monkey mouth, the eyes narrowed to slits, and there was the dumb, pleased grin of a happy man, ridiculous, feeling his luck and wondering why. And Ebert says, I couldn't improve on that. I couldn't improve on that. You know, it was almost luck, you know? And if you go and you find, like, eventually getting drunk all the time, it's not going to be productive, and you're not going to find that happiness there. And eventually Bukowski eased up a bit too. You know what I mean? So
yeah, I hear you. But, you know, in Barfly and in Factotum, there's no doubt that he kind of admits to everyone that he endlessly mailed letters. I mean, mailed his stories to publications, you know, where, he put in a tremendous amount of effort to get his work published, to get it.
Of course.
It's not true. Like, you know, if you watch Barfly, and like he says, there's something he writes in Barfly where he's like, yeah, I always knew I'd get discovered, but I thought it would be, you know, after I was dead. But it's not really the case. You know?
It doesn't just happen when you're bumbling around drunk and then all of a sudden you become a brilliant writer who's published in the New Yorker. It doesn't work like that. As much as it's nice to dramatize that romantic notion,
right?
It doesn't happen. And just like Hunter Thompson, that guy is way, like, if you read Leaving Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, yeah, the guy's writing is way too lucid to have been written on a fucking ether bender.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So, like, it just doesn't happen. It's like, it's nice for, you know, when you're 20 to think that it happens like that, but it doesn't.
It doesn't happen like that. And again, it's like, even like, say, with, like, you know, some of our rock heroes like Jim Morrison, like, you know, there's this whole fantasy that, you know, he was constantly just like drunk 24 hours a day. And, you know, but it's bullshit. Like, I've heard Ray Manzarek say, listen, there were 3, 4, 5, sometimes a week would go by, the guy wouldn't drink and just concentrate on writing, you know.
Of course, man. And, you know, he was his own publicist. So he was plotting, he was busy writing his own myth, the same way that Bukowski's writing his own myth here. I feel really bad that Max isn't talking. Get him in, Dom.
I know. Max, Barfly, I mean, is this not the, like, ultimate, like, honestly, the ultimate drinking movie?
Don't throw me your shitty bones. That's a terrible question. God, you two are fucking 69ing over here, and I'm like, Jesus Christ. That's a terrible question, Tom. I think you need to come out here, and I think you need to let me take you to East Hollywood. I'm going to take you to all these bars, and I'm going to inspire you, because if you want to channel Bukowski in a productive way, I've said it a million times, you need to set deadlines for yourself. You're working a working man's job. You're working in a fucking pizza parlor or whatever. You're manning the oven. But you're a very bright guy. You have a ferocious wit. And clearly, Joe, fair to say, the guy can write a little bit.
Sure.
So why don't you write, Tom? Why don't you do something like that?
Well, see,
means so much to you. Just mimic him until you find your own voice. Why aren't you writing about living with your father?
Why do you always
That's
say that?
That's an entire novel. That is an entire novel
really
sitting in your head
true.
That you would rather, I don't know, watch movies on
he
Netflix.
Lives,
or,
he lives, in all fairness, he, well, yeah, that's all I do. In all fairness.
It's opening day and I got to watch the Mets.
Oh my God, I would die. Grown man, almost 40, living with his dad, and you don't want
to. But this is bullshit because he lives with me. Like, it's not like the opposite. That you're portraying it to be. Like, I moved in.
What do you mean it's bullshit? Okay, I'm sorry. He's living with you. Okay. Now that we've switched that around.
Okay.
There's your novel. If you want
to
write.
It is something to write about, Tom. But you know what? Just what we were saying, Tom. Yes, look,
thank
I don't
you for saving.
This, I'm sorry. I don't want to bring this into that. But just like we were saying is that, yeah, it just doesn't happen. I mean, you know, it's just obvious. You don't stumble around drunk and then one day you're, you know, a fucking published writer in the Guardian or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
You got to work at it, you know. And
I mean, Tom, do you enjoy writing? I mean,
I always did, and I wrote a ton. I mean, when I was playing with Jeff, and I mean, there would be a day go by, like a day would not go by where I wouldn't.
What did you say about the Dagos?
I know there would not be a day
hey,
that
Tom,
doesn't like
just,
that at all.
That's my cousins you're talking about.
I'm not Jersey. I don't watch The Sopranos.
I don't watch The Sopranos.
Yeah.
I'm not.
It's my family.
Me a bunch of Complete non sequitur.
No, but Tom, when you guys seriously, get, yeah, sorry. if you had to categorize yourself in one form of artistry, besides being a podcaster, so to speak, what would you say? Would you say a writer?
No, I how could I even say something like that when I really truly haven't written anything?
Well, you know? I don't know. It just seems like you're screaming to write. I know that, and I loved your review, and I totally identify with your identification of Hank Chinaski, because this is far and away, of all cinematic Bukowski, this is far and away the best we're going to get. Absolutely. Sean Penn, for a while, was supposed to make Post Office. That shit didn't happen.
Right.
At least we have Hollywood, which is, I think it's his second to last novel. It might be his last novel, I think Hollywood was, where Bukowski wrote about, you know, writing this movie and dealing with Hollywood fucktards. But, you know, there are things that you can do, even though you're not grubby. Well, I hope you're not grubby, because you said you don't understand getting your teeth cleaned and that you didn't bathe. I don't know. I don't know how.
Well, Bukowski said the teeth cleaning thing. I mentioned.
Okay, I know you threw a lot of quotes in there, but I want to just clarify for the audience what was Tom and what was Bukowski quotes.
Well, yeah, that was a real. It was kind of interesting. Tom was alternating between his own writing and
Bukowski's. I did. And Bukowski's, between each paragraph.
Yeah, it was a child of both of you, and that's great. But I just want to make sure that we're clear. My point is, Tom, you obviously, this struck your soul in many ways. Bukowski, his writings, Mickey Rourke as Hank.
Yes.
I'm saying, in a productive way, just like Joe is saying, you could reinvigorate yourself if you just saw this film again recently.
Yes.
You could reinvigorate yourself, which seeing the film again did for you. It reinvigorated you towards a new form of creativity that maybe you haven't explored in a while.
It's true. There's no doubt about it that I would – listen, I mean, I compiled notebooks. I got rid of all these notebooks, which was like when I – like, this is what I was talking about. Like, when I was, like, 34, 35, like, I put all that crap behind me. And I'm like, you know what? I'm buying new clothes. I'm getting my hair cut. I'm shaving. I'm going to start taking life more seriously. And I threw out, like, a ton of notebooks, you know, where I just – it took me, like, 10 years to compile all this stuff, songs, poems, some short stories. And I kicked myself to this day. But I felt like I needed to do it because otherwise I wasn't going to change. Otherwise I was just going to continue to want to be a bum, basically.
Are you keeping a notebook now?
No, I don't write anymore. That's the thing. I don't. Like, I don't have a notebook where I'm writing observations, thoughts, poems, whatever.
Why don't you take yourself out on an artist date, go to this new bar, have yourself a drink.
Right. And sit there.
Buy a notebook.
Yeah.
Listen to me.
Yeah.
Buy a notebook, go to the bar, and sit and just write a series of one-sentence observations about your dad. He sits all day in front of the TV. He wears an undershirt, and he wears – and I'm not saying your dad does this – and he wears his underpants on my furniture. Just write a bunch of different notes, and then just see where that goes.
Okay.
Work it out. Work out your relationship with your dad.
Well, I can almost bring this back. I could bring this back to the film, actually. It's something that I've been sort of thinking about, and what I was thinking about with this film is that, you know, what Bukowski's doing here is essentially writing himself as if he were a separate character. Like, right. He's mythologizing himself.
Himself,
you know? And there's all this like he's writing himself as an almost another character, and it's something I've been actually thinking about doing. And Max, I guess you did it. You changed your name.
You've been thinking about mythologizing yourself, Joe?
Well, when you start to make a work, if you separate yourself from yourself, from your own ego and your own whatever it is, and you start writing about your thoughts as if they were somebody else's or something like that, you know what I mean? It's liberating to do something like that. So it becomes yours, and it's something else at the same time. So it's actually really helpful to think about writing in a character, even if you're writing in the first person, you're writing in your character. Just the way that Bukowski's doing in this film is he's writing about himself as if he's some, you know, beat angel or something walking around these bars, you know?
Right, right. No, that is interesting. Yeah,
I don't know. Maybe I'm forcing you into something you don't want to do. It just seems
I'm trying
to read your subtext.
No, man, Max, don't think that what you're saying is not sinking in and motivating. It is. I think, and after watching Barfly, I thought about those times where, like to me, like the beauty of the evening, like, you know, the drinking, you know, dedicating myself to the drinking, it was like a gamble. It's like gambling, but you always win. You know, it's like, you know, I could take $100 and I could bet on the Knicks, but there's a 50% chance that they're going to lose. Like, if you take that $100 and you throw it out into the evening of drinking, it's like you're always going to get something out of it. It's like maybe I'm going to meet a woman and I'm going to go back to her house, or she's going to come back to my house and we're going to have a great night. Or I'm going to, you know, just meet new people and I'm going to be up all night talking to them about, you know, the way the world works. Or I am just going to get drunk and that's going to be, I'm going to pass out and that's going to feel good. Or, you know, or I could just wind up coming home and taking out my notebook. And these were some of my favorite nights, and just writing pages and pages of thoughts. You know, I used to love those nights. It's like, you know, I mean, that to me was a big win, coming home at 2 o'clock in the morning with a six pack and just sitting, putting on music, you know, and just sitting there and writing. I adored all that. But there was something that happened to me like 5 or 6 years ago, and I gave up on it. And there's a fear of going, like, it's not easy for me to go back into, because I don't think I'm that person anymore.
You know what, Tom? It's like we were just talking before we even recorded these shows, where you were talking to me about making my videos. I gave up on making videos.
See, there you go.
You gave up on your writing.
Yes.
I identify with that. You get older. You get more tired. You come home and you've worked all day and you're just spent.
Right.
And how the hell are we going to manifest our artistry into productive ways again? I mean, I feel like, well, as long as I have the occasional job, there's my expression. I just expressed myself and I got paid for it, and now I'm tired and all I want to do is go home and distract myself from the pain. So in more ways than you'll ever know, I totally identify with what you're saying.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear that, because I think that sometimes you think that I'm just like, yeah, not hearing what you're saying, man. I do hear what you're saying, and I would love to get there. It's just not easy for me. Trust me, after watching Barfly, I was like, I should just stop being a wimp. I'm like, why am I being so wimpy? Why does everything have to be like now?
What do you mean by wimpy?
Because everything has to be planned. Like, I have to, everything has to be specific for me. Everything has to be planned out. Like, you know, my, like the night that I'm going to drink, it has to be on this night, and I got to have this, and I have to have, you know, I have to.
Well, Joe, am I wrong? That sounds like responsibility.
It is.
Yeah. I think this is the issue is that you're tying getting drunk with being creative. And I think that at some point, it's natural and healthy to disassociate those two things. Like, I think at some point, yes, when you're younger, especially, you could get blasted and you can obliterate yourself, your inhibitions and, you know, your self filters or whatever, and you can write something good or whatever. But at some point, you need to try to figure out how to do it without getting blasted, and you don't need to. You could be spontaneous with your art, whatever it is that you're gonna do. And yes, but Max, I do understand what you're saying, man. You get older and you're get tired, man. I mean, especially when you're working and all this other shit. You know, it gets harder and harder to do that. But you'll actually find it more enjoyable, Tom, and more productive, because I know. Listen, I've been where you think that this that Bukowski's at, or where Bukowski is showing is where he's at, where you get so loaded that you forget everything and you wake up and you have a poem in your hand and you're like, holy shit, yeah, how did I write that?
Right.
But you could be just as you could be more productive if you can get to a point, and it takes hard work, but it's better because you could be more lucid when you're doing that, right. When you start working and you're not loaded and you force yourself to shut yourself in a quiet room or whatever and write or paint or whatever the fuck it is that you do. And then all of a sudden, and you're way more productive. You just become more productive and lucid because like I said, this guy's, it just doesn't happen that you're stumbling out and drunk and then all of a sudden you're a famous author. You know, it doesn't happen like that.
No.
You know, he's working really hard at doing this stuff, and you can work better if you can learn.
But the process itself could wind up just being cathartic, you know, and healthy. And that
without being drunk, you don't need to be drunk. It could be really healthy to sit down and write something. Right. Like, did you sit down and write that while you were drunk?
No, I thought about doing that. It's so funny. Last Thursday when I had a few drinks, I was like, I thought to myself, I'm going to write the Bukowski intro when I'm near the end of the evening, and I'm just going to write the intro drunk. And I didn't do it. I'm like, you know what?
And it never works out. Of course. So there you go, man. So you don't need to be drunk to write something worthwhile. So all it takes, here's what it takes.
Poetry is different with me. It's like
Tom, read other poets.
I do. I have.
They're not drunk when they're writing.
But we're talking about like me and the way my mind and my body works.
I don't know. I'm not going to say what you are or not. But here's the secret is this, and it's not a secret. It's just discipline. And and the only person who's in charge of your self-discipline is yourself, you know? So it's hard. It's not easy. You got to sit down and you got to, if you say you want to write a book, 150 pages, make yourself write that fucking book.
Tom, we got to listen to this guy. This guy has two kids, a wife, and a job, and he's making short films, novels, screenplays. You and I are sitting around with our fucking fingers up our ass.
You know what? I feel like I'm not doing anything. On the days that I'm not doing anything, I start stressing the fuck out because I'm not doing something. And you know what? Today, today, okay, I designed a trade show booth. like it's a creative act. I wrote a review, and I'm doing a podcast, and I feel like I'm not doing anything.
That's absurd.
Exactly. I have a sickness. My sickness is the other way. Like, if I'm not writing, if I'm not actively working on some project as shitty as it might be, I feel like I'm fucking wasting my life, you know? And it just doesn't happen. Like, yes, Tom, believe me, I'll sit down with Ronnie and get loaded and I'll scratch out, you know, six lines, but that's different than writing something that's like, it's different. It's much different than writing like when he sits down and writes Post Office or Ham and Cheese or whatever. Yeah. You know, he's sitting down and writing.
Ham on rye.
Ham on rye. Sorry.
Ham and cheese. Ham and cheese with that relish. Was my breakfast. And mustard. Fuel.
To all my friends.
But I know that night, dude, because, see, the end of the climax of Barfly was like, that, like, you give me a paycheck every week when I'm like 26, 27, 28 years old, that fucking joke, that paycheck would be gone by Saturday morning.
I hear you, man. I've been there, dude.
Paycheck. The entire paycheck. And I loved it. I was like, you know, I would go those 5 days, 4 days, you know, with being broke and maybe, you know, pushing myself into somebody else's world and having them buy me drinks.
Yeah, you're living as a character that you're writing. Yeah.
You're talking like I'm right now.
There you go. See? It's just I'm just lost in it, Joe.
Yeah. Well, hey, whatever, man. You find your own way, you know.
Do you guys need a moment alone? Because I can leave.
No, but you know what I do want to do? I love this discussion, and we're going to continue to talk about drinking and all this craziness. Let's move it on to leaving Las Vegas. Max is going to give us the introduction. Max, why don't you take us there, brother?